Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, his mercy has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The members of Mount Olive Lutheran Church in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, welcome you on this, the third Sunday after Trinity. Our order of worship is Divine Service, setting 4, beginning on page 203 in Lutheran Service Book.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong and nothing is holy, multiply your mercy on us that, with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we may lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Old Testament lesson is from the prophet Micah, the 7th chapter. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. He will cast all our sins in the depths of the sea. You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Epistle lesson is from St. Paul's first letter to Timothy, the first chapter. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. Though formerly I was a blasphemer, persecutor, and insolent opponent, but I received mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I receive mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, "There's a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. When he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' The father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they begin to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you, and I have never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. When this son of yours came who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found.'" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Our next hymn is hymn number 608, "Lord, to you I make confession."
Lord,
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This last week in Choristers Camp, we studied so much scripture and so many Bible parts. I was having lunch with one of the kids and I said, oh, there's so much to talk about. The sermon needs to be like 2 hours long. And he immediately looked up and said, well, you better have some pretty good jokes in there. So I've been told it won't be 2 hours. But we could look at the prodigal son narrative and Psalm 103 that we sang together. And the prodigal son is so different depending on where we put the emphasis. To save some time, I'll suggest right away, we don't emphasize the son. We don't emphasize the return of the son, the repentance of the son. Yes, of course, repentance is precious, daily part of our lives. But this son wasn't so repentant as we might think he was. What did it say? When he came to his senses, it didn't say he came to faith. It said when he came to his senses, what does he say? It's not that he trusts his father. He trusts his father to be loving and forgiving. What does he say? I'll tell my dad, make me like one of your hired servants. Hired? What does hired mean? Hired means pay me. Is that repentance? Pay me. I work, I earn, you pay me. I get to show that I'm responsible once again. I get to stand on the 2 feet of my own work and righteousness, and I have dignity. Everything that I have, I've earned. No. This is not the Christian faith. That would be preaching the mistake of moralism. That would make the faith, again, mostly all about us and how hard we try and our New Year's resolutions, our New Week's resolutions, and checking our boxes week by week, not so different from other world religions that can all give you a list. That would be moralism. That would be the gospel is just this little safety net if and when you make a mistake, but we'll spend more time talking about you. The gospel of Christianity is not a little safety net. The gospel is the whole message of 100%. How is anybody saved? What does Scripture say about our efforts, our good works, all of our supposed righteousness? The Bible says all of our good works are like filthy rags compared to God. Only God is holy. We are sinners. And in the Christian faith, we confess we have nothing to offer God. We can't pay him off. And we never will. Now, that last part gets to be a bit of a problem for Christians to wrestle with. What do you mean I never will? I'm a sinner. That's what I do. I'm not a sinner because I sin. I sin because I'm a sinner. Every week, no matter how many resolutions I make, I don't have anything to offer to God. I can't make myself holy. I can't produce holiness or manufacture holiness that's outside of what God in his love chooses to give me. This is not like a hypothetical at your workplace where the good old boss says, well, you've been a good employee for 10 years. We'll overlook this little mistake you made in the books this time. Well, that might be gracious. You might be happy. But that's not God's grace. The good news of Christianity is not that you get to try again. Try harder. If you really think about it, you'll make this week better than the last one and the next week better than the last. That's not us. That, in fact, is simply the demands of the law, again, just repackaged a little bit. Work, be perfect. Well, we can't. The Ten Commandments are good. The Ten Commandments are true. The Ten Commandments are righteous. But the Ten Commandments don't make me holy. The Ten Commandments prove to the world that I belong in hell. So we don't emphasize the Son's work in this. We emphasize the Father's active forgiveness in this narrative. And the Father is very active. He is looking every day from a long way away. His heart is yearning for his Son. He sees his Son when he's still far away from home. He runs a cross-country race in public. I couldn't do that. Runs to get to his Son. He throws his arms around his Son and hugs him close. One, to make sure he doesn't wander off again. Another, maybe to make sure the townspeople don't beat him up because he deserved it. The Father hugs him close. The Father gives him a new set of clean clothes. Sound familiar? The Father gives him sandals to show that he's a member of the household. The Father gives him a family ring. The Father gives him the fattened calf. The Father gives him a celebration. Everybody celebrates because of what the Father says. My Son is back. Now, all of this happened before the Son ever gave his greasy little speech. The Father didn't see that, the Son is now a reformed character and has shown that he is now responsible, and. No. The Father showed love to his Son because he is the Father, because this is the Father who forgives sinners who don't deserve it. That's what grace is. It is unmerited. It is undeserved. This Father gives and cleans and restores those of us who have no holiness of our own to offer. And this is so consistent with the whole rest of the Bible. The reading, the Old Testament reading, what Paul was writing about today, especially the psalm that we all sang together this morning. All through the Bible, and especially early on, Exodus, Leviticus, when God is teaching his people who he is and what his name is, he says, I am the Lord who sanctifies you. And he repeats it a lot. I am the Lord who sanctifies you. I am the Lord who sanctifies you. I make you holy. If we ever have trouble with what is sanctification, that's our answer. The Lord makes us holy. Our holiness comes from God. Our righteousness isn't ours. It's what God gave us. It's all throughout the scriptures. I am the Lord who sanctifies you, who makes you holy. In Psalm 103 at verse 3, this is the God who forgives all your sins. That doesn't just mean the sins of last week, that also means the sins of this coming week, as hard as we try. The sins of this coming year, no matter what resolutions we made. The sins until we pass away and go to heaven at the age of 102, or whatever we make it to. My whole life of sin is forgiven by God, including my temptation to try to be dignified and stand on the feet of my own righteousness and rely on my own efforts to try to make myself holy. That's not the faith. Psalm 103 says, the Lord works vindication and justice for the oppressed. And don't limit yourself by thinking of earthly justice or social justice. It's so much fuller than that, so much better than that. In truth, I'm just guilty. But the Lord works justice for those who are oppressed by sin and the accusations of the devil. Justice is the cross of Jesus Christ that takes away the sin of the world. Justice is served. and completed. All the penalties for our crimes against God are paid for. There are no outstanding debts. Because there are no outstanding debts, you are declared innocent and you're free. Not only free to walk, but you're free to go back to your Father's house. He does not deal with us according to our sins. He does not repay us according to our iniquities, our sinful actions. We have no holiness of our own, but he fills us up with his holiness as a free gift. You and I were not fit to enter God's presence even. Just like the Old Testament tabernacle that we studied last week. The glory and holiness of God were so bright and burning, Moses couldn't even set foot in there. But at the place of sacrifice, that is, at the cross, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world washed away our sin. Our sin is paid for, and we meet God. As we were washed in baptism, we were made clean, miraculously clean, and so God made us fit to enter into the holy place. At the crucifixion, the temple curtain was ripped from top to bottom. God ripped it, we didn't. And just like the book of Hebrews says, we enter in behind the curtain and stand in the presence of God. And we're upheld by the Holy Spirit himself. And our prayers go directly up to our Father without any go-between. And we eat holy food of God's house. The true manna that comes down from heaven. The bread of life. Jesus. The body and blood of Jesus himself. So God has put a new song in our mouth, not the old song of our own efforts and failings, but the song of the true good news of the Christian faith, that he has washed us, he has brought us back, he does love us, he has cleaned us up and restored us, and he says he makes you a nation of priests. After we have become a priestly people, he's given us, by the power of the Holy Spirit, a whole new way of life. Not just our old actions called nice, but by the Holy Spirit, a whole new way of thinking, of speaking, of acting. Not to earn our status as the people of God, but because he's already given us this status of the people of God. We know we have the forgiving Father. And this is given to all nations on earth. There is the forgiving Father. He makes us holy. He brings us back to himself and hugs us close. All out of the love of his heart. Thanks be to God through our Savior Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We confess together this, our Christian faith, in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, have mercy on our brotherhood throughout the world who suffer persecution for the sake of Christ. Assure them that they have suffered, after they have suffered a little while, that you will restore, confirm, and establish them. Lord, in your mercy, We thank you that you have blessed so many women among us to serve in your kingdom with the various talents that you give them. As the Lutheran Women's Missionary League concludes their national convention here in Milwaukee today, we ask you to grant them safe travels as they return home, and we ask for your continued blessing on their untiring support of our collective mission to reach more people with the saving gospel. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, have mercy on those who are ill or in need of healing, especially Julia and her family, Leah, Miriam, Dorothy, Tommy, John, Geraldine, Marie, William, Marlene, Kathleen, Kathy, Kurt, Janice, Vivian, Braden, Pam, Peter, Pamela, Ruth, Dick, Karen, Bob, Jim, Jerry, John, and Marge. Also those who are in hospice, especially Dave. Bless them all with strength and faith in their times of need. Bless the work of medical professionals that they may serve as your instruments of healing. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you are the good shepherd who provides under-shepherds to care for your flock. We ask you to give discernment to Pastor Shim as he considers a call to serve at beautiful Savior Lutheran Church here in Milwaukee. Give him confidence in your divine providence. Lord, in your mercy. We ask you to bless and keep those serving in the military, both here and abroad, especially Joshua, Lance, Tristan, Adam, Riley, Brandon, Jordan, Catherine, and Matthew. We ask for your continued blessing on all emergency personnel, that you would keep them safe and also bless their work so that we may all live in peace and quietness. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who are homebound, especially Miles, Anita, Janet, Laura, and Karen. Give them comfort in the knowledge that they are not alone, that you will never leave them nor forsake them. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, bless our school and that our efforts to prepare a new generation in the faith to serve you. Bless our teachers and their families as they enjoy rest and relaxation together over the summer. And bless our preparations for the coming school year. Lord, in your mercy. Oh, Lord, grant us good government. Safeguard the freedom of Christians across the globe and thwart the plans of those government leaders who overstep or misuse the authority that you have given them. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord God, look with compassion upon all those who are suffering from hunger, homelessness, poverty, discrimination, reduced employment, or unemployment. Have mercy and take away their sufferings. Move us all to be your instruments of mercy and grace to those around us. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, you have given us a promise of your mercy and grace through your Son. While we live amid many troubles in this sinful world, remind us by your word that you do not deal with us according to our iniquities, but are merciful and gracious to us. Call us to repentance and faith that we may take up our crosses daily and follow you in the way that leads to everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the offering. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. And because he has now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Blessed be you, O Lord our God, King of all creation. If you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may faithfully eat and drink the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink of it all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Our communion hymns are hymn number 640, "Thee We Adore, O Hidden Savior," hymn number 626, "Come, Let Us Eat," and hymn number 612, "As Rebels, Lord, Who Foolishly Have Wandered."
Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. John, could I have you come forward, please? Beloved of the Lord, John O'Connor has accepted a call to a new field of service in the church. In this time of farewell and Godspeed, let us hear the word of the Lord. Reading from Philippians chapter 1. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I'm sure of this, that he who will begin a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partners with me of the grace. And from 1 Corinthians, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Let us pray. O Lord God, merciful and gracious Father, we give thanks for all the blessings you have bestowed on our congregation, school, and its parents and children through your servant John. By your word and spirit, preserve him in the one true faith. Grant him faithfulness in his new field of service and readiness to grow in wisdom, knowledge, and skill for those he serves, to the glory of your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace and joy. The almighty, merciful, most merciful God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and bless you and strengthen you for faithful service in his name. Thank you.
Our final hymn is hymn number 919, Abide, O Dearest Jesus.